Hello class, Professor V here. I hope this message finds you happy, healthy, safe, and sound heading into our final week of the semester. It's gone so fast, hasn't it? So much has happened, and I hope everyone's enjoyed what we've learned and that you all keep up your political activism and that you stay in touch. It's been great, and hopefully this review here will help you all get ready for the final, and you'll be smooth sailing through the new year. So what I'll do is I'll just basically give you a summary of the things that you need to study for the test. I won't go too into detail because I want you all to go study it, but I'll definitely give you the outline, delineate for you the things that you should concentrate on for studying. So let's start at the second half of the semester. And with the second half of the semester, and by the way, if I go out of order at all, don't worry, because as long as you know this stuff, it doesn't matter where on the test it comes, you'll be good to go. So forgive me if I do go out of order. But interest groups and lobbyists, one of the first things we covered in the second half of the semester. So if you all remember, we talked about a couple things. What is an interest group? What defines the word, the term interest group? And this is what I'll ask you on the test. Can you tell me what an interest group is? And tell me four examples. I might say three, but just be safe, no four. Three or four examples of real life interest groups that exist today in the United States. So that's up to you. Choose your favorite top three, top four. And then be able to also tell me what lobbyists are and what do they do to get what they want on behalf of the interest group. Some of the things we discussed are legal and good, perhaps objectively, and the others are unlawful and bad and can get you thrown in jail. So as you guys remember, the Jack Abramoff video, 60-minute interview. We watched the bite-sized version, but you all saw the corruption that can exist with lobbyists. But I want to be clear that that's not all lobbyists, and that there are other things that lobbyists do besides corrupt acts in order to get what they want on behalf of their interest group. So know what an interest group is. Be able to name four. Just to be safe, might ask you to name three. I haven't written the test yet. And then be able to tell me what a lobbyist is and what do they do on behalf of interest groups. And for that, definitely be able to name four methods that lobbyists use on behalf of their interest groups to get what they want. And I'll give you a big hint. Usually what an interest group wants is to either change the law, keep the law the same, or perhaps tweak the law in favor of their interest, which is why we call them interest groups, right? Okay, so we also covered third parties, or not Republican or Democrat parties, if you want to say it that way, parties that are not the two major parties, and we discussed in detail why they don't win presidential elections in our lifetime. And we basically went through a pretty comprehensive list. There's way more than four things we covered, but to be merciful, I'll ask you to know your top four reasons why only Republicans and Democrats win presidential elections in the last century. Why is that? And there's a whole host of really interesting, at least I think they're interesting, hopefully you do too, interesting reasons why third parties struggle so much to get even one electoral vote. And just a little reminder, if you remember the last time a third party candidate was in the debate for the presidential debates was 1992. So we've gone quite a long time, right, without even having a third voice or fourth or fifth in the debates. If you watch the three presidential debates this year, it was only two. Trump opted out of one. But if you watch the debates, since 92, there's only been a Democrat and a Republican. That's it. So that's a big clue, a big hint to study for about why third parties aren't successful in winning elections. However, there's some light at the end of the tunnel, if you all remember in the lecture. If they get to 5% of the popular vote, I'll leave this for you to study. There's some sort of light at the end of the tunnel that they could have. So it's not a wasted vote necessarily to vote third party, but it is pretty certain, at least the way things stand now, that the candidate you're voting for, if it's a third party candidate, statistically doesn't have much of a chance to win. So I want you to know at least four reasons why that is. And one more hint, the Electoral College is probably a really important thing just to be able to remember the basics of. Remember that in 92, Ross Perot was a billionaire and he got on the debate stage against the Democrat and Republican Bill Clinton and George H.W. Bush. He got almost 20%, almost one out of every five voters in America voted for him, and he had zero electoral votes to show for it. So that's an example I hope you remember, because it just kind of illuminates our point that it's really tough for third parties to get a victory in the presidential elections in the United States. Okay, so then we have politics in the media, and a couple things that you want to just remind yourself is that the media is based on what is most popular for their viewers, and why do they show what they show on the news? Why do different news channels like Fox News and MSNBC and CNN, why do they cover the stories that they cover? And the bottom line is it's about money, right? And the way that you can judge that and prove your point is by that example I gave, which is the Super Bowl. Every year, you're going to have a commercial for 30 seconds and you're going to pay $3 to $5 million. That amount could go up. But that's a sort of a bare minimum. $3 million for 30 seconds of ad time in the primetime Super Bowl timeout type of situation. Now, if you're like me and you love football, the world's football, porque football es el idioma de todo el mundo, then you'll be watching El Copa del Mundo, and you'll be watching, which is the World Cup, and you'll see a Coca-Cola commercial, and I'm sure that the Coca-Cola commercial cost $3 to $5 million as well. So why is it that an advertiser like Nike, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Walmart, whatever, why would they pay that much money to get 30 seconds of airtime? And the simple answer is because so many people are watching. Otherwise, they wouldn't pay that much, right? They would be losing money. But if they put that money forward and there are 100 million people watching the Super Bowl or about a billion watching the World Cup, then it's probably a pretty good investment, right? So if you can, go back to that lecture and just kind of look through and be able to name, four characteristics of the media. One, which I just discussed, is the big one, is that they're motivated by money. And then we also talked about why is it that a media outlet would want to tell the truth? Why wouldn't they lie? Now, also, they can lie. They can lie, and some do. But why is it in their interest not to lie? I'll give you a hint. They're going to lose credibility, right? And if you lose credibility, you lose viewers. And if you lose viewers, you lose what? Money. And advertisers aren't going to put millions of dollars into a show where there's only a handful of people watching, right? So that's a huge one. And then we also talked about, let's see, trying to go in order here the best I can. IOUSA was a little documentary. I showed you guys the bite-sized version. I think the full one's about 90 minutes. I think you all watched the half-hour version. But it got us into a great discussion on the US national debt. I would like you to know, within $1 trillion, and that's a pretty big margin, what is the US national debt? When that lecture I first did, it was 26 and a half trillion. It's almost 27 and a half trillion now. So if you want to split the difference and say about $27 trillion, that is the right amount. That is the current amount of the United States debt to other countries and to other people. And then what you'll need to remember is, how does the US borrow money? Does someone write us a check? Why don't we just print money? This is important. And most of you all did great in the discussion of understanding why we don't just print money and just pay back with that. Simple, easy guess for you to remember is the I word, inflation. And in economics, that's a devastating word because it means that you've printed too much money and that the money that you have in circulation is now worthless. It's basically meaningless. If you go to Zimbabwe or Germany back in post-World War I, it's easier and cheaper literally to use your money for toilet paper than it is to buy toilet paper with the money. People having wheelbarrows full of cash to go and buy, a bottle of water. Because why? Well, because when something is rare, it's valuable. And when something is not rare, it's less valuable. So think about a diamond, right? If you could find diamonds as easily as you could find pebbles on the street, diamonds wouldn't be worth very much. How much are you going to pay for a pebble? Probably about half a cent or 1 cent. No, does that make sense? So again, just a simple understanding of that. I'm not going to go too deep for, I won't ask too much detail, but just know these four things. Know what a budget deficit is. Know what a savings deficit is. Know what a trade deficit is. And know what the leadership deficit is. Okay, so that's all delineated, which means outlined in that movie and in the lecture that I did for that week as well. And so if you can understand those four things and explain them, even within a sentence or so, it doesn't even have to be an essay or anything like that. Short answer is fine. You can get right to the point. But be able to explain those four sort of deficits that lead to this $27+ trillion debt. Because if you add all those up, that's why we're in the position we're in, speaking of the United States and the US government. All right, so that's a huge one. We also talked about civil rights, and civil rights are, if you all remember, the battle for equality under the law. We have some more in detail definition if you want to go back in your notes and look through that lecture as well. But what I'd like you to be able to do for civil rights is to be giving me a basic definition and to be able to give me four examples. There are more, but give me four examples of civil rights that are being fought for in the United States today or civil rights that have been fought for in the USA in the past. So if you want to reference, say, Martin Luther King Jr., awesome. If you want to reference, women's rights today, we talked about, just for one example, the wage gap between men and women in the United States. It's huge, and it's, unacceptably high. That's a perfect example of civil rights that are still being fought for. So civil rights is, arguably a never-ending quest, right? Depending on what you stand for and what you're pushing for. But in terms of equality under the law. Then we have civil liberties. Same thing I'm going to ask you here is basically what are civil liberties? And some people just use the term civil rights and civil liberties interchangeably, and it's incorrect to do that. Why? Well, because civil rights are the government giving you rights and protecting you under the law, whereas civil liberties is the government's getting out of your way. The government's restraining itself and letting you make a choice. So civil liberties are a lack of government or government restraint. And in that area where the government has not intervened, that's where you get your civil liberty. So you could talk about anything from the First Amendment, which is, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of the press, freedom of assembly, and the right to petition government for a redress of your grievances. That's all one amendment. You could also talk about, for civil liberties, and this I think will be helpful, look at the first, so know the First Amendment, which is the one I just covered. Know the Second Amendment, which is, if you're more conservative Republican, this is going to be something that's different interpretation for you of how far this right goes, but the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, to have guns. If you're more liberal or democratic, you might say, well, we need to put limits on what kind of guns and how much ammunition people can have. But regardless of where you fall in that spectrum, you know I will never grade you down based on your opinion politically. So feel free to express it, but just know the Second Amendment as well. So first, second, and then the Fourth Amendment. Huge civil liberty. It's probably my favorite civil liberty if I had to choose one. The Fifth Amendment has a civil liberty in it, and then the other one I'll probably ask you about, or at least expect you to be able to know, is the Eighth Amendment. So go look through those if it's not ringing any bells. Just give you a hint that the Fifth Amendment is a big amendment, has a lot of different stuff in it. Everything from double jeopardy to eminent domain to the right to remain silent, right? And then the Eighth Amendment has two different major things: no cruel and unusual punishment, and no excessive fines and bail. So, and we had a great discussion with you all about what counts as excessive, right? And for a billionaire, $1 million bail is nothing. But for the rest of us, we're gonna be sitting in jail until the trial if we can't afford bail. So, those amendments will really help you understand civil liberties, and you could actually use those as your four examples of what real life civil liberties are, just the way that you will have given me four real life things that civil rights categories that are being fought for or have been fought for in the United States. One other thing that just came to mind, I will probably ask a separate question, just one single question about affirmative action, because it falls under the umbrella of civil rights. I want you to just know both sides of that issue. Know why some people want it and think it's good, why some people don't want it and don't think it's good. Just to give you a hint, it's pretty politically split between conservative and liberal, Democrat, Republican, not completely, but largely, depending on which side of that debate you fall on, it's probably going to be determined by your political ideology. So, know a positive and a negative. Let's just be safe. Let's say two positives and two negatives about affirmative action, pros and cons. And then moving on, this seems like we're getting through it pretty fast, but I know it's a lot of information. But this will, you'll be fine. This second the test, I find that most students, even if you did poorly on the first one, students do much better on the second one. And if you've already done well on the first, you have even less reason to worry because you know more or less how I'm gonna give the exam and what to expect. So, and plus you got this review, right? So last but not least, we talked about foreign policy and why does the United States have Israel as arguably its closest ally. And this is probably the most controversial lecture that almost any teacher in political science could give, because it involves religion and politics. There's an old joke that says, if you ever go to someone's house for a party or get together for the holidays, there's two things you'd not to talk about so everyone can still get along. What are the two things people say don't ever talk about in a party setting or in a festive setting? When you just want to get along, the two things people say don't talk about, religion and politics. But what is our last question here? It's about religion and politics. So feel free to share this with your friends over holiday time at your own discretion. But in all seriousness, we talked about three main monotheistic religions, which means the belief in one God, and their claims to the country of Israel, the state of Israel. We have Islam, we have Christianity, we have Judaism. What I want you to know is just one thing, one belief from one general belief, one general doctrine, one general creed from each of those religions regarding Israel. In other words, why is Jerusalem slash Israel important to Muslims? Why is Israel slash Jerusalem important to Christians? And why is it important to Jewish people in terms of religion? This is a really important question. And again, I'm not taking sides. I don't expect, I don't, you can take a side if you want. I don't expect you to have to take a side, but I want you to know from each of those three religions' perspectives why they feel that Israel, that what claim they have, what stake they have in Israel, right? So once you've done that, that is probably a question I'll stand on its own, like the affirmative action question, because it's just I feel it's really important for people to know just a little bit about world religions in order to understand world politics better. And I know it's American politics course, but we got to cover foreign policy, and only got about a week to do it. So I wanted to choose the most controversial thing, but also one thing that I find students asking me when I didn't teach this a couple years ago. This was what I got the most questions on. It's like, what is this whole thing about Israel and Palestine? What are the Palestinians' grievances? What are the Israeli claims, etc. So now you know all those questions. And the final thing I'll ask you then about Israel's beyond religion is what makes Israel's relationship with the United States special? In other words, unique, or what is a way to show that the United States gives favor to Israel? Remember, there's some big things like Israel is the only nuclear-powered country that is an undeclared nuclear arsenal. In other words, the government will say we can neither confirm nor deny the existence of a nuclear program or nuclear weapons, which is another way of saying, if I come down in the middle of the night and I see that my kids have gotten into, the cookies or whatever, and I said they couldn't, and I ask them in the morning, hey, did you have any cookies? That those are supposed to be saved for, later. And they say, I can neither confirm nor deny that I had a cookie. I probably get a good idea that maybe they did eat it. And so that just in and of itself is controversial, right? But there are a couple other reasons we talked about as to why the US, besides religion and besides nuclear weapons, that the US is allies with Israel. And in what other ways can you tell me? You need to know four. So if you want to put nuclear weapons as one, that's totally fine. And then go back through your notes in the lecture and look at least three other reasons why or how the United States gives Israel different treatment, has a closer friendship with, closer allies, why they're closer allies with Israel than, say, basically any country on earth. Okay. And all of the reasons are basically controversial, right? So last but not least, I want you to understand what is the Palestinian perspective? If you were taking the other side of the argument and you're saying, okay, Israel is this great friend of the United States in terms of governments, but here's why that's bad, or here are the negatives about it, the pros versus and then the cons, be able to at least explain to me, in your own words, why Palestinians would say, and those who support Palestinians would say that Israel's in the wrong. Again, I'm not taking a side on this. I won't take a side on it. It's not my place to do so. I don't want to do so, but I really want you all to understand both sides. It's going to be so helpful as you read world news, as you interact with the international students, or maybe yourself, or you travel. It's just really good knowledge to have. So, without taking sides myself, I encourage you to know that material about Israel and Palestine, just so at the very least, you have knowledge of it going forward. And when you read about it in the news, you can understand both sides and what more or less is being argued about and being argued over. What are the controversies, etc. So, with that said, looks like we made it through our list of things to cover. So, hey, it's been a really fun semester. I know it's not the same as meeting in class. I wish I could give you all, a handshake and a high five. Well done. But virtually, we're doing it. Great job, everybody. I really hope that you stay in touch. I hope that if you have political questions in the future or political ambitions, I'll be the first one to support you. So, stay involved. If nothing else, I just stay aware of what's happening in the world, because it really, hopefully, as this semester has revealed, it really does affect us. Politics really does affect us. My goal is always just to take the average student who doesn't really know or care about politics and have them find it at least somewhat interesting. So I hope I've succeeded in that way. And you're not, yawning and falling asleep through each lecture. So Thanks again to all of you. Hope you have a wonderful holiday season. Hope that next year is it fair to say better than this year? I think we could all maybe hope for that. So I'll sign off for now, but hope everyone is well. Have a great holiday season, a great new year. Good luck on the exam, and I will see you soon. Professor V signing off.